So in this lecture, I want to take you through seven limit laws. Now, if the limit actually exists, there are seven laws that you should know about. Now, seven sounds like a lot, but it really isn't. Actually quite simple, because then add, subtract, multiply, and divide a few limits. But these are proper laws. If the limit exists, you can apply them, and that'll make the calculation of the limit very easy. So in this chapter, I want to have a look at the limit laws. Here they are, seven of them. I suppose they're not really laws, but they do work for us in that regard. One thing about them is, while you've got to learn how to apply them, please, please, please remember they only apply when the limit exists. Now, what comes first? Do I show you when limits exist or not, or do I show you the laws first? Well, that's kind of a chicken and egg thing, so let's go for it this way. But remember, this only applies when the limit exists. If the limit does not exist, then these laws don't apply. And we'll go through examples and you'll clearly see what's going on. Now, these aren't difficult at all. Let's start with this first one. It says the limit as t approaches some constant c, and then you have the addition or subtraction, there we have addition or subtraction of two polynomials. And that can be rewritten just as the limit as t approaches c of each one of them. There we have the f of t and then we have the g of t. So you can just write the two limits separately. It's as if you're distributing the limit inside of the parentheses there. But don't see it that way. The limit as t approaches c of the addition or subtraction of two polynomials equals the limit of each of those subtracted or from each other or added to each other. Second one's just as simple. If you have the limit as t approaches some constant of another constant times a polynomial or times some function, or I shouldn't just call these polynomials actually, any kind of function, you can simply write that as this constant times the limit of the function itself as t approaches some constant. So that you can almost say we can just bring that out. We can bring out that constant. Now we have the limit of the product of two functions as t approaches some constant. That equals, yes, you guessed it, you can take the limit of each of those functions and then multiply the result with each other. Just the same for quotient. Just remember, now that sign just means for all, slightly incorrect use of it, don't matter. For all, so just see that sign is for all. So the limit as t approaches this constant of the f of t divided by the same for the g of t for all cases where the limit of g of t does not equal zero. Really, we all know we can't divide by zero. Now, this one will help us a lot. I have this limit as t approaches c of some function squared. So this function here is squared, and that is the same as taking the limit of the function, and that result that you get, you then square it. And it's not only just for square. It works for other powers as well. Now, the limit as t approaches some constant of another constant equals just that constant. Nothing changes. And then the last one, the limit as t approaches c of just t on its own equals just that constant, where t here is just, that's just some function of t, isn't it? I suppose you can just write the function of t equals t. That's what we have in this instance. And you're just going to replace the t with this constant. So they're the seven. As you can see, they are really not that difficult, but they help you tremendously in solving limit problems. Now, the best way to understand these limit laws is to use them in action. Now, look at this. We simply have a function here, f of t, and that f of t equals t cubed minus 2t squared plus t. And remember what we said, if the limit exists, now you don't yet know when a limit exists or doesn't, but let's say that all the examples here, the limit actually exists. We can just take the limit of each of these. So this we could have seen as, let's say this is the g of t and the h of t, and let's just call it the m of t. So the g of t was t cubed, the h of t was negative 2t squared, and the m of t was just t, so we can take the limit of each of these, and then look, indeed, this is what we've done. We keep saying that the limit as t approaches 2, just as it was there, And now we just take the limit of each of these separate polynomials. So the easiest way to do this, what is the limit of t cubed as t approaches 2? Well, we just put 2 in the place of t. That's going to give us 8. Here we have our negative 2, and look at it, we're actually making use of one of the other limit laws. We're bringing the negative 2 outside, and there it is. Still with that negative sign there, the negative sign there. And then in place of t, we just put 2 again. And remember, the limit as t approaches 2 of t, well, we just replace t with 2. So it's actually more than just the addition of and subtraction here of polynomials. And that's just a simple arithmetic. And we see that the answer is indeed 14. Let's look at one of the other laws. Here we have the limit as t approaches 2 of 3t cubed. And here we have this constant k, which is 3, and we just bring it outside here, as you can see, of the limit, and then take the limit of this polynomial, which is t cubed. Now, later on, you'll see again, this is that law where we can just take this power and take that outside. So just take the limit as t approaches 2 just of t, which will just be 2, and then cube it, which is 8. But the same happens here. The only law I want to show you here is just to bring out the constant outside of the limit and then still take the limit of this variable. So you can't bring that variable out, but you certainly can bring constant coefficients out, and we've done that with a 3. And then as t approaches 2, we can just replace 2 in there. 2 cubed is 8. 8 times 3 is indeed 24. Now, let's have a look at this. In this example, I've got two polynomials, t cubed and t minus 1 squared. There's one, there's the other, and I'm multiplying them with each other. So what can we do? Well, we can just take the limit of each of them individually and then multiply that result. So the limit as t approaches 2 of t cubed, well, this is 2 cubed, which is 8. And the limit as t approaches 2 of t minus 1, or 2 minus 1 is 1 squared, is just 1, and 8 times 1 is 8. So all I've done is I've taken the limit of each of these two polynomials separately and then multiplied the result. So in this example, we have the quotient of two polynomials. There's our f of t in the numerator, and there we have our g of t in the denominator there. Now, first of all, let's have a look. We're taking the limit then of each of them individually. We've just got to make sure that this does not equal 0. And at least, if I plug 2 in there, it's 2 minus 1 is 1, squared is 1. So certainly there's not 0 in the denominator, and we get to a solution of 8. So look at this. We have one polynomial divided by the other. We're taking the limit of that. We can just take the limit individually then of the polynomial in the numerator and the polynomial in the denominator. And here we've got this example. We've seen it before. I can simply just plug the 2 in, and of course that will be 8. But I just wanted to show you, when you have a power up there, so this is this polynomial. So there we go. It's this polynomial to the power 3, t to the power 3. I can simply take the limit then just of that polynomial, and then at the end cube the result there, and I get to 8. So no matter which way around I do it, I can take that power outside of the limit. Shouldn't use those words, but that's what we do. And then get the limit of just of the polynomial t, or you can just plug it in and just do it the regular old way. Works in either case. Okay, these things are getting embarrassingly easy. We've got the limit as t approaches some constant, which is 2, of another constant 3. Well, this has got nothing to do with this t approaching 2. There is a constant there. It is just 3. Simple. And here we have our last example. Very simply, the limit as t approaches 2 just of t, just of the variable. And we can just replace it with 2. In there, and the answer being 2. So these last two really are simple. So there you have it, all the limit laws. So please use them. They're so easy to use, but only when the limit exists. And eventually we'll get to when a limit actually exists and it doesn't. For now, just enjoy these limit laws.